Hello, and welcome to this introductory video on using Web of Science. I'm Kristen Adams, Science and Engineering Librarian at Miami University Libraries. Today we're going to be covering general search strategies and the citation tracking feature available in Web of Science that sets it apart from other databases. Web of Science covers quite a few different subject areas across the sciences and engineering, and actually consists of several smaller separate collections that you can search separately or all at once. But because this video just covers the basics, what we're going to be seeing is applicable regardless of which collection you're looking at. All right, let's go over to the library's homepage to get started. Okay, so here we are at the library's homepage. And to start with, we're going to go to Databases A to Z, which is this first icon right here. And the Databases A to Z list is a total listing of all of the databases that the library subscribes to. We're looking for Web of Science, so we'll search for that. Okay, and we've actually got more than one choice here when we're looking at Web of Science. We've got the first one here, Web of Science All Databases, Web of Science Core Collection, and if we scroll down, then we can see that there's even more choices. And the reason for that is that Web of Science actually consists of several smaller databases, which you can search together or separately. We're going to look at the Core Collection today, so let's choose that one. Okay, now that that's loaded, we can see that we are in the Core Collection in the top of this bar right here, and if you click on this drop-down menu, then you can actually switch which sub-collection you're looking for once you're already in here. All right, and today we're going to be looking for aquaculture, and we're going to add another row, and we're going to look for North America. And right now it's set to all fields. That's going to give us a really, really broad search, and we want to be more specific. So we're going to go with topic, which is basically keyword. So let's change that for both, okay, and we'll do search. Okay, so here's our results screen. We can see up here at the top we have a total of 363 results for that search. And that's not too bad, but we'll try to narrow it down so that we don't have quite so many to look through. So to do that, we've got some refine options over at the side. The ones here at the top, you can limit by highly cited papers, review articles, early access, open access, and those with associated data. And let's choose the associated data to help us narrow our search. We'll choose something else when we get down here too. Let's scroll down. You can choose publication year, the document types. Most people are looking for articles. There are other types of documents in here, including book chapters, proceeding papers, or conference papers. Let's click articles, come down here a little bit more, and we've got some Web of Science categories. So those are really useful to click on or look at if you're looking for other sorts of keywords. If your search didn't go quite as you expected it to, then using some of these terms can help you kind of narrow your search and use the same terms that the articles are cataloged by. But let's scroll back up to the top. I think that's good for now. We'll click refine. Okay, so here's our new search results page, and that's really narrowed it down because we only have 5 articles to look at now. Okay, so let's have a closer look at the search results screen because we didn't do that on the last page. We've got the different articles here. So we've got the title, the authors, the year, part of the abstract, pretty typical stuff that you would see in any scholarly database. But we also have something unique. We've got the citations and the references. So the citations are sources that have used this article to write their research. So that's going forward in time, and going backward in time is the references, which is basically everything that this article has used in its bibliography. And what's really neat is that you can click on these and see what articles those are. And that's a really, really useful search strategy that makes Web of Science so powerful, because not many other databases can do that kind of thing. Okay, so let's choose one of these articles and open it up and see what they have on that page. Let's go with number 3 here. Okay, so we've got a repeat of some of the information that they had on the search results page. We have the title, the authors, and the full citation information, including the journal and the volume and issue number, everything that you would need to write the citation. It's got the full abstract, and if we scroll down, it has the keywords, some of the author information, their institutional affiliations, and this one also, because we clicked on an article that has associated data, it has some information about where you can go and find the data at. And then at the bottom is the funding information. A lot of research is funded by various agencies, government agencies, or businesses, companies, and things like that. And if that's the case, then the authors are required to let you know where they got their funding from. And it's really handy, actually, if you're doing research to look at this so that it gives you a little bit of context for the research. But also, that's another way to find similar sources. So if something's funded by this one particular grant, say, there's usually more than one research article that comes out of a grant. And so if you look by the grant number, then you can find a lot of related research articles. Okay, so let's say that we've thoroughly checked this one out. It looks good. We want to read it. So let's go back over to the top, and we're looking for the full text. But in Web of Science, the full text is never going to be there because Web of Science just has the information. It's what's called an indexing database. database. And so what you would need to do is click on this yellow Find It button. Okay, so after you click on that Find It button, then you'll get a page that looks like this, and it will let you know which databases you can access that article through. Sometimes there's just one choice. In this case, there's multiple choices. It's not that any of them are better than the others. It just means that we have it in multiple places. So you can just click whichever one you feel like. Let's go with this one. Okay, now we're in an entirely different database altogether. It's an EBSCO one. Here's the information about the article again. And now instead of the Find It button, then we have the full text PDF and we can click on that to open it. So that's great. It turns out that we did have access to this one. That's not always going to be the case. Let's take a look at an example to see what we do when we don't have the full text. So we're back over in Web of Science and I pulled up another article. Let's click on the Find It button and we have a similar sort of screen as before. This time it says no full text has been found online. So what you want to do in this case is under Request Item, there's a link to Interlibrary Loan. So if you click on that, then you'll be prompted to log into your Interlibrary Loan or ILL account and request the article. And then usually within a couple of days, you'll get an email that says that your article is ready. You log into ILL again, and then you'll be able to access the PDF from there. Okay, so that wraps up this video for today. I hope that you learned something about Web of Science. If you still have questions, though, please do ask a librarian. We're always here to help, and thanks for watching.